we have been talking about how to break destructive patterns. And how many would just give a quick show that this has brought some things to attention in your life? You brought some things in your life have just been brought to attention that you need to deal with, and we need to, you know, break. Oh, praise God. Praise God for it. Well, we're going to finish this up, Lord willing, today, talking about destructive patterns. And we've talked about individuals. We've talked about Lot and Balaam and Saul and Solomon. And last week we talked about Judas, but we're not going to talk about an individual. We're going to talk about individuals, and we're going to talk about the children of Israel, the whole group of the Israelites today. So a pattern, let's go over it again. What is a pattern? A pattern is a reliable sample of traits, acts, or tendencies, or other observable characteristics of a person, of a group, and we're going to talk about a group here today, an institution. It's a behavioral pattern. It's something that happens on a daily basis. It's a daily routine. It's part of our daily grind, something that is repeated many times without even thinking. In the book of Psalms, chapter 85, verse 8, it says, I listen carefully to what the Lord is saying, for he speaks peace. Everybody say peace. He speaks peace to his faithful people, but let them not return to their foolish ways. In other words, it's saying you were foolish before and God brought you out. So let's not go back to what he brought you out of. Hello, can I get a witness? Proverbs chapter 9, verse 6 tells us this, abandon your foolish ways so that you may live and proceed in the way of understanding. And when I read that, that means this, if I go back, I'm not going to proceed on the way and I'm not going to have godly understanding. Something's going to clog the flow of my understanding if I go back. How many have ever gone back before? That'd be everybody in this room. But God has called us to a way, and he's called us out. That's why I love the scripture that says he had called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. So once we've been called out, let's not do something foolish and go back to the old ways. Let's not go back to those foolish ways of doing things, because it's like a dog in Proverbs chapter 26, 11, as a dog returns to its vomit, so a fool does to his folly, again and again and again. So if you would, you can grab your copy of God's Word and turn to Matthew chapter 21, and we're going to be read through verses 1 through 11. We're going to break these down a little bit, but follow me. If you want to follow on the notes, you can go to the YouVersion Bible, go to the events page, and you will be able to see all the notes. If you log into Hope Church, you'll be able to see all the notes that we're preaching from today. Also, how many have had the opportunity to grab a hold of the Hope Church app? Very good. I encourage you to do that. If you've not done that, we can walk you through and get that on your phone. We will soon have all of our notes on there as well, but we also have this entire series put together in a series package that you can go back and learn and take notes on, and so I'm excited about that. So Matthew chapter 21, verse 1, it says this, as Jesus and the disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the town of Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, and Jesus sent two of them on ahead. Go on into the village over there, he said, and as soon as you enter it, you will see a donkey tied there. It's with its colt beside it. And untie them and bring them to me. And if anyone asks what you are doing, just say the Lord needs them. Chill out, and he will immediately let you take them. In verse 4, it says this, this took place to fulfill the prophecy that said, tell the people of Jerusalem, look, your king is coming to you. He is humble, riding on a donkey, riding on a donkey's colt. The two disciples did as Jesus commanded, and they brought the donkey and the colt to him and threw their garments over the colt, and he sat on it. And most of the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others cut branches from the trees, and you should have gotten those at the door. Come on, wave those in the air if you've got some of those today. Some of them cut branches from the trees and spread them along the road. And Jesus was in the center of the procession, of the parade, and the people all around him were shouting, "Praise God for the Son of David. Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in the highest heaven." In verse 10, it says this, "The entire city of Jerusalem." Everybody say entire. What does entire mean? The whole lot of them, right? "The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered. 'Who is this?' they asked. And the crowds replied, 'It's Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee.'" Holy Spirit, speak to our hearts. Somebody say, "Lord, speak to my heart right now. And help us to understand and help us to break these destructive patterns in our lives." In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. So as we've talked about destructive patterns in our lives, it's something that happens over and over again. We want to break this down even farther. And so, number one, we're talking about destructive patterns. Destructive patterns, number one, they often hide behind their worship. Destructive patterns hide behind worship. Now look at this, Matthew chapter 1 and verse 8 through 9. "Most of the crowds spread out their garments on the road ahead of him, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And Jesus was in the center of the procession, and all the people around him were shouting, 'Praise God for the Son of David.'" Everybody say this with me. It's on the screen right behind me. Let's say this together. Praise God. Come on, let's start it again, because we need to act like we really mean in this today. Today is Palm Sunday, so let's reenact that day. Take your little palm branches and raise them in the air. Raise them in the air like you just don't. Okay, come on, let's get this going. Here we go. "Praise God for the Son of David. Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in the highest heaven." Now, what they didn't realize is they weren't just saying something to say it. They were actually praising God. But in the midst of it, they were hiding. Those destructive patterns in their life were hiding behind their worship. Well, what do you mean? The children of Israel had a tendency for thousands of years to completely destroy every single messenger that came their way. They didn't like what the prophets had to say, so you know what they did? They'd kill them. They'd stone them. They would reject them. They would reject the judges in their life, and now they wanted to be like every other nation, so now we give us a king. We want a king. And because of their arrogance, because of their stubbornness, God brought them out of Egypt and set them up, and they were doing good. But then next thing you know, years down the road, they continued to worship other gods along with God himself, along with Yahweh. And they had a mixture going on, right? They had a mixture of worship. And because of that, God said, "All right, you're going to do it your way? I'm going to bring somebody else in." And guess what? They hauled them all away into captivity again. Again. And now, Jerusalem is completely wiped out. God had mercy upon them. God had placed it upon a pagan king's heart to worship God. They had seen God do signs and wonders and miracles. Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? God showed himself favorable. And now all of a sudden they're like, "You know what? It's time for you to go back. It's time for you to rebuild the tabernacle. It's time for you to rebuild Jerusalem, because that's God's house, and I'm going to send money, and I'm going to send armed forces, and I'm going to send people there to help, and you're going to do it." God brought them back out. And here they are years later, because they still couldn't make it right. God knew the plan in the very beginning in the Garden of Eden, that we couldn't be perfect, right? We couldn't do it on our own. We couldn't follow the letter of the law, because the law kills, right? The law kills. And so here they are. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise be the one in the highest heavens. Praise all ye heavenly hosts, right? And so they were worshiping Jesus, but they weren't worshiping him as the Messiah. They thought they were setting up another king. Here comes another king. Here comes the Son of David. Right? Right, here comes the son of David. And so what we see here is that destructive patterns will hide behind worship. That's why when we come into the house of the Lord, we can come in on any given Sunday. We can still have destructive patterns in our life, but we can still praise God. We can still praise God and still not walk in deliverance and freedom from those sin, from those lying, from that cheating, from that addiction to sex, from the addiction to alcohol. We can still worship God, right? That's hard stuff. That's hard stuff. And destructive patterns, what they will do, they will many times, and we talked about that last week, about they've got chameleon characteristics they can blend in, right, Sister Geneva, right? They can just blend in. But what happens is, if we're not careful, we'll go on fooling ourselves, because when you're in the presence of the Lord, you sense His presence, and it feels good to be in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And we exchange feeling good for what's doing what's right. So we'll come to church hiding behind our worship, but yet the rest of the week we're all running miserable. Anybody ever done that before? Man, that's rough. That's rough. Destructive patterns, they hide behind worship. But see, what I found is that you can't hide anything from God. You can hide stuff. You can even try to hide stuff from yourself, right? You can fool yourself into thinking that I'm all right. All I got, boy, if I can just get to church. Can I tell you, Jesus is the answer. Church is not the answer. We come to church to worship together, to spur one another on. Church will not save you. Hope Church won't get you into heaven. We just give you the tools and the equipment to help it easier to get along the way. Hello. It's only Jesus Christ that can save, deliver, and heal. But if we're not careful, all worship will just hide those destructive patterns, and no one will ever know. Well, how do you know, Pastor? Because I've seen the man jumping up and down, praising the Lord on a Sunday morning, but no one knows that he beat his wife on Saturday night. Ain't nobody got time for that. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. For the word of God is alive. Everybody say alive. It's alive and powerful. It's sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked and exposed before His eyes, and He is the one to whom we are accountable. We can hide all we want to right now, friends. We come in and hide, but there's going to be a day that we're going to be answering. We are going to answer for every thought we want to. And I've had Christians argue with me about this. Once I get to heaven, friends, it's right here in the Word of God. We will give an account of every word that we speak. You can be saved into heaven, but we're going to stand before our God and give an answer for everything that we've done. Right? My, that's good preaching. No one even knows it. All right. Number two, destructive patterns. Destructive patterns fail to recognize Jesus. What do you mean? Well, look at it. Matthew chapter 21, verse 10 and 11. The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar. They were going crazy, right? They're in an uproar. Who is this? You ever seen people get excited and they don't know what they're excited about? What's going on? What's going on? I don't know, but everybody else is excited, so let's just follow along. I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm following Morgan. I don't know. He failed to recognize Jesus. Well, who is this, I ask? And someone gives an interpretation, but it's not entirely accurate. Yeah, Jesus was prophetic. My goodness, he's the epitome of the prophetic nature. But they said, he's just a prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. So let's just, that's all he is. Who is it? You see, that's what I find, is the destructive patterns in our life. Jesus wants to break them, but we don't know the power and the might of Jesus himself, that he can really come in and break these things in our life, because if we really knew it, those destructive patterns would be gone. See? My. Matthew chapter 16. Turn there real quick. 16:13. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? Who is this guy? Who's this cat that's coming through Jerusalem? Well, they replied, well, some say he's John the Baptist. Some say he's Elijah. Others say he's Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. And then he asked them, but who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter spoke up and he said, Jesus, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, you are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from any human being. You see, destructive patterns, if you just let them go in your life, they're going to fail to recognize who Jesus really is. And the question is this, not who do you say, disciples, I'm asking you today, who do you say Jesus is? We can read the word. Let's apply it right now. Right now. Who do you say that Jesus is? Who do you say that he is? Because what I found is many people, they make broad statements that denounce the power and the authority of Christ. Well, my marriage will never change. Well, I'll never be healed. This job, I'll never get a better job than this. Do you hear that? When you make broad statements like that, you're denouncing the power and the authority of Christ, who has a hope and a future for you. You take that and you put it down and you squash on it, and you really don't know who Christ is then. If you think that the good old days are the best and the glorious days for your life, you aren't looking forward and ahead to who Christ really is. He's the one that's redeemed you. He's the one that's brought you out. He's the one that set you free. He's the one that will totally transform your life. But when you say, well, it'll never change, it'll never change. You don't know who Jesus is. You don't know the power and the authority of Christ. Well, Pastor, you don't understand. You ever walked in my shoes? Man, you ain't walked in Jesus' shoes either. You don't know who Christ is when we act like that as believers. I'll tell you this, even someone has even thought that even yet this morning. You get so frustrated because you've prayed and you've prayed and you've prayed. And you don't see the results that you think you need to see. Can I tell you this? If we really know, and can I just talk to myself today? If we really knew who Jesus was and who he was, what he was truly capable of, we would pray and then we would learn to wait well. Because otherwise, what we're doing is acting like a bunch of fools with a Jesus tattoo right across our forehead, and we can thump our Bible all we want to. Can I tell you, you can quote the Bible and still not live it. So the question is, who do you really say that Jesus is? He's all powerful. He's almighty. He is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, more than we can ask or imagine according to his power that's working within us. Everybody say, Number three, destructive patterns. Destructive patterns, what I have found is this. They have the wrong MO. That's short for motivation. Right? They got the wrong MO. Look at this. They just got through, the Bible says, and I'm a literalist when it comes to the Word of God. I believe when God's Word says something, that's exactly what it means. God's not putting something in His Word to trick us, to deceive us. Now, there are things that we do not understand yet at this time. Right? I believe in Genesis, it was an actual 6 days and He rested on the seventh. Right? I don't think it was too much of a job for it to really be 1,000 years. I'm not a gap theorist person because they go through and they say that a day is like 1,000 years and 1,000 years is like a day. I'm not that guy. I'm not that guy. I can still talk to you and be your friend, but I'm not that guy. I believe that God is all powerful and He's almighty, that boom, boom diggity, He did it all in 6 days. And then the seventh day, He's like, I'm going to take a break here, right? I believe that. And so when it comes down to it, and when it comes down to God's word, I believe what it says. And when it says the town was in an uproar, when Jerusalem was in uproar, I believe that was everybody in it. It was going crazy. They didn't have sound systems. They didn't all have that, but they had their shofars. And when they get the little, and they had a little toot thing all around the place. Can I tell you, people were in an uproar because they're like, wow, what's going on? See, they were under the tyranny of Rome at that time. They were under the terrible pressure of Rome and it the hideous nature of even their presence that was there. They were pagan. They did not worship God. It was horrible. And so when Jesus came on the scene and now all of a sudden He's doing all these miracles, they truly believed that they were bringing in, and Jesus riding in on the donkey, remember? A donkey, even in King David's day, they set his son Solomon on the king's mule. And he came trotting in on the scene and they set him up. That's what they were envisioning, that they were going to set Jesus up as the new ruler of the children of Israel, the king over Israel, the king over Jerusalem. That's what they were thinking. And so here all along, they're like, praise God, hoot, hoot, hoot. The disco ball's going and like, yeah, we're going to party tonight, right? And they got this all going. But what they didn't realize, they had the wrong motivation. They had the wrong MO. And that's what destructive patterns will do. Destructive patterns will blind its host, if you will. They will blind its host so that you can't see what's really going on. That's what happened right here. So here they are. Jesus comes riding in on the donkey. People are praising Him. They're throwing their coats down on the ground. They're cut off palm branches, and they're praising God. And it's not the right kind of praise, but they're praising Him nonetheless. Still deceived, still discombobulated. It was just a mess, but they're still praising God, right? Not getting anything fixed, and Jesus rides in, and everybody's all happy, happy, joy, joy, and Jesus comes in on the scene in Matthew chapter 21, verse 12, and it said this, then Jesus went straight in and entered the temple, and all of a sudden, He began to drive all the people out because they were buying and selling animals for sacrifice. He knocked over the tables of money changers and the chairs of those selling doves. He said to them, the scriptures declare my temple will be called a house of prayer, but you have turned it into a den of thieves. Jesus came in on the scene because they were turning the temple, the place of sacrifice. They weren't there to worship God. They were there to make a profit. So they were bringing in all the cattle. They were bringing in all the donkeys. They were bringing on all the stuff. And instead of praising God, they're making deals. Hey, you need a bull? You got some sin in your life. You need to get this one over here because this is the one the Lord's really going to accept. You know what? It just went up. This guy over here said he's going to give me 500 smacks. But this guy over, you're going to give me 1,000 for this? And see what I'm saying? They weren't there to praise God. They were there to make a profit. And so Jesus rides in on the scene. They're calling Him prophets. Prophet. There you go right there. Jesus comes in on the scene. He goes directly to the temple and sees what was going on. And He drove them out. What I find about destructive patterns is this. Destructive patterns like to be challenged, but they don't like to be changed. Destructive patterns, they can come to church And they can see all that's going on and all that stuff, destructive patterns. You can still live in it, and you can feel good. Oh, man, the pastor stepped on my toes today. I hear that all the time. Oh, the preacher, man, he stepped on my toes and all that stuff. But, friends, you can have your toes stepped on all you want to, but unless we get changed by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, what good is it? You see, a challenge will last for a season. A change will last for a lifetime. Destructive patterns love to be challenged, but not changed. But I want you to look. This is the same story, but this is a different scripture, a different version of it. Now, we've been reading out of Matthew chapter 21, but look at what John has to say. They call these Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they call them the synoptic gospels, because you can lay them out. How many have ever had a Bible to where you can lay them out side by side and see all that? That was one of my favorite classes in college that I went to. The teacher's name, my professor, his name was Wave. That was his first name, Wave Nunnally. It was awesome. I think he came from California. I think he used to be a surfer. I don't know. That's the only thing that I understand, that the parents named him Wave, right? John chapter 2, verse 15, it's the same story, but it's through the eyes of John instead of Matthew. And it says this: Jesus made a whip from some ropes, and he chased them all out of the temple. He drove out the sheep and the cattle, scattered the money changers' coins over the floor, and turned over them their tables. Now, this is the same story, but it gives you a different picture, that it wasn't that he just clippity-clock, and all of a sudden he gets off and he's like, get out of here, you know, all this stuff. Can I tell you, it would take time to make a whip. When we read scripture, we need to look at it in real time. Jesus, you can almost see the righteous indignation, and he's making this whip, and he's like, boy, I'm going to get them. Oh, it's coming out right now. He's getting ready to go, and you can see it speeding up at the end, and all of a sudden he's like, psh, psh, he's scattering all the church folks out. He's scattering all the church folks out because they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. So let's fast forward all these years later, after the Holy Spirit has come, after the baptism in the Holy Spirit has come, and we're supposed to be the church of the last days. Friends, my question is, are you in church giving away money and selling all kinds of stuff that you shouldn't be, instead of praising God? Would Jesus run us out of this place today? How come my heart's beating and no one's saying anything? Can I tell you something? Jesus wants us to be the church that he can count on, not the church that he's got to run out of. You see, destructive habits and destructive patterns, man, they just have the wrong motivation. Man, I just got to get a church so I can feel better. We come to church so we can be changed, so we can come to the altar because of the blood of Jesus Christ, so that he can wipe out the garbage in our lives. And can I tell you, we got garbage in our lives. And I'm speaking to myself. When you're more focused on coming to church and being to church on Sunday, but we've not done one bit of witnessing to anybody this past week. Jesus came to seek and to save that which is lost. We're found. The last time I checked, you and I are found. But each and every one of these seats represent a lost person. Do you understand? I don't mean to be dramatic, but do you understand that I believe the Holy Spirit weeps when there's an empty seat, because we haven't done our job. See, no one likes to amen on stuff like that. And I'm talking to myself. You see, destructive patterns, they've got the wrong MO. They got the wrong motivation. In Hebrews, and I I'm going to start to land the plane. Everybody say, Pastor, land the plane. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24, it says this, let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. And let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do. See, they even calling it back then, right? As some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. Dear friends, if we deliberately, listen to this, this is what's scary. He's speaking to the church. If we deliberately keep on sinning, hello, you with me? After we have received the knowledge of the truth, there is no longer any sacrifice that can cover these sins. I don't know about you, but man, that's a cup of coffee. McDonald's coffee spilled on you in the driveway, right? That's exactly what that is. There is only the terrible expectation of God's judgment and raging fire that will consume his enemies. You see, this is where it comes down to it. When we look at it, but Lord, Lord, did we not cast out devils in your name? Did we not teach a fresh start class in your name? But Lord, Lord, did we not greet this Sunday morning and hand out the little bitty palm branches that Pastor wanted us to do? But Lord, Lord, did we not socialize at the coffee bar, right, and eat Mike's donuts? But Lord, Lord, in your name, did we not cast out devils? And then he turns around and he said, you may have known me, but I didn't know you. Depart from me. You see, when we study that scripture, we find that he's speaking to people in the church. So that tells me that there's people in the church that really aren't saved, but they're doing all the things that little church people are supposed to do. And I say, Jesus, have mercy. Have mercy. So how do we break? How do we break this? You see, the entire children of Israel, they struggle with this for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. And even yet today, they still don't believe Jesus is the Messiah, because some of the leading priests, when Jesus rose from the dead, they said, oh, well, they stole his body away. That was the rumor that was going on. They started that rumor. And do you know that they still believe that to this day? They still believe that to this day. And they're still waiting for a Messiah. They are God's chosen people. But chosen or not, you've still got to choose him. So how do you break destructive patterns in your life? How do we break destructive patterns in our church? Right? Number one, take yourself to the woodshed. Come on. How many have no idea what the woodshed is? Oh, boy, we got some young ones around here. Can I tell you? You get taken to the woodshed. Basically, it's this. You're going around back, and you're going to get a whooping. Back by the woodshed where no one can hear, or no one can hear you screaming and crying and acting like a crazy person. You're going to go get a whooping somewhere. Take yourself to the woodshed. We've gotten this idea, well, if I need to someone, just tell me what's going on. Maybe you already know what it is, and you can take yourself there. Take yourself to Jesus. Take yourself. You don't need me to come in and pour into your into your life and go in to read your mail. We bring in Jeremiah Johnson, and he read into your life. You already know what's going on in your life. How about taking yourself to the cross? How about marching yourself up to Jesus and say, you know what, Jesus, I did this, and I'm sorry. Can you help me out of it? Instead of getting caught in it, you bring yourself to the cross. The Bible talks about this in Galatians chapter 5, verse 24. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful nature to his cross and crucified them there. Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Here's what I found out. We want to be crucified with Christ, right? We take ourselves to the woodshed, and we can get up on that cross, but we got the hammer and the nail, and we can come in and we can nail our feet to the cross, all right? And we're good. We're kind of stuck there a little bit. We're like one of those little signs, just like, all right? So here, what are we going to do right here? We got the nail over here, we got the hammer. We can kind of hold that right here, and we go and nail that. But here's the problem. We got this going on over here. Don't worry. There will be someone else in your life that will come along the way to finish up nailing you up right there. There'll be someone that can't mind their own business and look at their own stuff, and they'll nail you right there, and you're good to go right there. That's what I found out. You see, if we will simply come to Christ, if we will come to Christ willingly, not because Pastor Darrell said so, but because you feel the conviction and the leading of the Holy Spirit to bring yourself out of sin and stuff like that, and bring yourself out of these things, can I tell you, it's better to come to Christ on your own than to have someone kicking and screaming and dragging you there, because it won't stick if that happens. Number two, how do we break out of this of the church? Number two, circle up the wagons. What? See, I'm bringing in old people terms right here. Circle up the wagons. You see, when the enemy comes, what they would do in a wagon train, they would circle up the wagons so that they would have a barrier and a protection, and we could rely on each other. Friends, can I tell you, when you see someone struggling in sin and struggling, don't just ignore them. Help them. Just don't ignore them. Help them. Oh, well, I ain't going to get into their business. Friends, we're in the business of spurring one another on, helping one another live this life to the very best that we can live it. We need help. We can't do all of this on our own. We need help. And that's why we got to, if we're going to break these patterns or not, you got to circle up the wagons. The Bible says this in Psalm 119, verse 171. It says, let praise flow from my lips, for you have taught me your decrees. No, that's not it. 1 Timothy, sorry, I jumped ahead. 1 Timothy 6:12. Fight the good fight. Everybody say fight. Fight the good fight for the true faith. Hold tight to the eternal life which is called you, which you have confessed so well before many witnesses. Friends, can I tell you, your salvation, sometimes you got to fight the devil to get through another day, right? And your salvation isn't based upon what you can do. Your salvation is dependent upon the precious blood of Jesus Christ. There's nothing you can do to earn salvation. It's a free gift that he's paid. He's already paid the price in full, right? You just got to go redeem the coupon, right? So you got to circle up the wagons, and you got to learn to fight once again. Fight the devil. Resist the devil. We talked about this last week. If the devil isn't fleeing, then you aren't resisting. Sometimes it takes a little bit more push, but you'll get there. Worshiping. I'm jumping ship. I need the whole worship team. I want you to come and get in your places real quick. All right? Number three. How do we break destructive patterns in our individual lives, but how do we break it in our congregation? How do we do this? Number three, I love this. Crank up the worship. Crank it up. Turn it up. Turn up the volume, friends. Turn up the volume. And I'm not just talking about on the radio. Turn up the volume in your own voice. Turn up the volume in your own spirit. Turn up the volume. When you're by yourself and you're worshiping the Lord, don't let it just be, oh, come to the altar. Come on, crank that up a little bit. Oh, come to the altar. Friends, can I tell you, when you begin to worship God with enthusiasm, instead of being this little timid whatever that we are, we can go crazy. We can go crazy at the baseball games. We can go crazy over March Madness. We can go crazy. But when it comes to worshiping Jesus, we're like, turn it down to zero. Crank up the volume. Turn up the volume in your spirit, friends. And can I tell you, when you do that, God will respond. God will respond. Turn up the volume of worship. Psalm 119, 171, let praise flow from my lips, for you have taught me your decrees. Let my song tongue sing about your word, for all the commands are right. Give me a helping hand, for I have chosen to follow your commandments. Oh Lord, I have longed for your rescue, and your instructions are my delight. So let me live so I can praise you, and may your regulations help me. That means to press through when you don't understand. That means to worship God through the storm in your life. Do that. Do it. And number four, Jesse, could I have you come up here real quick? Number four, start walking the talking. Now, we could talk a big talk, can't we? We could talk a big talk. Someone asks us to pray, all of a sudden we go into the, oh God, we blah, 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 blah. Right? How many know someone like that? You ask them to pray and they're talking like this, and all of a sudden you want to pray, it's like, dear God, we come to pray. Oh, good gravy. Come on. Communication is, prayer is simply just communication with God. Oh God, I need your help. When you call upon the name of the Lord, you don't have to turn to King James. Oh, God of all heaven, I call and I beseech you now. Come on, friends. We call upon the name of the Lord. We call, we cry out to him. God, I need your help. God, I need your help. Please come and rescue me right now. But it's time that we start walking the talking. Live your life every day as if you're dependent on God. Guess what? Because you are. Hello? 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 11. So keep on praying for you, asking our God to enable you to live a life worthy of his call. May he give you the power. Everybody say power. May he give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to do. Then the name of our Lord Jesus will be honored because of the way you live. And you will be honored along with him. This is all made possible because of the grace. That's the disclosure statement. This is all made possible. This is sponsored by. That's what it's saying. This is all made possible because of the grace of our God and Lord Jesus Christ. That's how we break it, friends. That's how we break it. And it can be done. Destructive patterns can be broken in your life. And I don't care if they're destructive patterns that you picked up last week or they're destructive patterns that have passed from generation to generation to generation. I've met pastors that didn't believe in generational curses. I've met pastors that didn't believe in generational things like that. And I said, so what do you call it when your great-grandfather struggled with alcohol and then his son struggle with alcohol, and there's alcoholic, drunkenness, all that. What do you call that? Well, it is what it is. Put whatever you want on it. It's a destructive pattern that has got to be broken. And it can be, because Jesus has all the power and the authority and the might to do so. And the same one that can break those destructive patterns is the same one that can open up doors of opportunities in the workplace. He's the same one that can heal your marriage. He's the same one that can change the trajectory of your children's life. He's the same one that can set you free from lying, from cheating, from adultery. He's the same one that can do it. And it doesn't matter what it is. Nothing is too difficult for Christ. Can I get a witness in this place? Come on, don't give God no golf clap. Come on. Can you all stand to your feet in this place?